Does the young superhero Naomi hold the secrets to stopping a new invasion from another world? Well, let's hop into the pages of Justice League issue number 60 and find out together, shall we? So then, picking up from where the last issue left off, a hulking monstrosity by the name of Brutus had broken into Earth from another dimension and was causing all sorts of trouble. The Justice League caught the case and eventually figured out that this monster, Brutus, had a very similar radiation signature as one young Naomi. Superman had gone to speak to Naomi, only to realize that Black Adam, the leader of Khandaq, had actually beaten him to the punch on this one. Black Adam obviously has a very personal reason for wanting to deal with Brutus, what with the creature touching down on his Khandaki soil, first and foremost. You know, it's one of those big honor things. Naomi, in an adorable twist, is just, you know, really stoked that so many people are so interested in her right now, and especially because she doesn't have to fight Black Adam like she thought she was gonna. Everyone opts to calm down and take a trip back to the Hall of Justice, where Naomi gets everyone who didn't read her solo series up to speed on what her deal is. She's a superpowered individual from another world that was raised in this one as a child. As it stands right now, Naomi's own world seems to be some sort of irradiated hellscape that fell to pieces when people with amazing superpowers, not unlike the Justice League themselves, decided to war with one another. Naomi claims that she herself has only been to this world of her birth for maybe 15 minutes, and that was when she was vanquishing her first supervillain. The working theory by Batman is that this jilted villain went out of his way to out Earth's location to some other interdimensional baddies. Furthermore, and I found this to be quite interesting, wherever exactly Naomi is, it doesn't exist in the regular multiversity map as we know it. Either because it's going to turn out to be really and truly special, or because this is Brian Michael Bendis writing all of this and he didn't want to have to put Naomi's universe somewhere in the bigger map if he didn't have to. The conversation then quickly turns to the topic of Black Adam, who followed Superman back to the Hall of Justice. The rest of the heroes don't exactly love the idea of having a strongman dictator in their midst. But surprisingly, Superman actually goes out of his way to vouch for this guy, saying that there were many times over the last couple months where Superman came to save the day, only to realize that Black Adam had actually saved it first. It seems that at whatever type of bad guy Adam was before, he's at a real crossroads now, and potentially, with the Justice League's help, he could find the inner hero that was always in him. It's Green Arrow who I think actually ends up walking away with the quote of the issue, saying, "Hey Superman, you know what the problem with arguing with you is? You're so good and so wholesome and so trusting, anyone who even tries to argue with you ends up looking sinister." And again, if that isn't Brian Michael Bendis just speaking through Green Arrow, then I have no idea what is. The team quickly gets alerted to another incursion attempt by Brutus. Though by the time they get there, it seems that he's far gone. It seems that this time, when the big horned monstrosity tried to break on into our world, he made the very poor choice of breaking into Paradise Island, where he was met by Queen Hippolyta. Though if you read Infinite Frontier in the Wonder Woman book, you'll know that Hippolyta isn't really queen anymore. She advocated the throne and gave control of the island to Nubia while she took up arms in a world that no longer has her daughter Diana to defend it. I will say this, Hippolyta gets several really badass hero shots throughout this fight with Brutus, and they add a couple new wrinkles to her character, saying that the long-living Hippolyta actually has a pre-existing relationship with Black Adam, and the two, surprise, surprise, have a pretty contentious relationship. Now, the good guys of the Justice League figure that they can't keep playing defense for every time Brutus comes through the portal. They don't know where he'll hit next, and it's not like they can just run after him the whole time. So obviously, the only right idea is to try and break on into Naomi's world and try and get him at home. The only problem is, Naomi doesn't exactly have full mastery over her powers yet, and it's not like she could just tear open a portal. Luckily for them, they have the Flash on their side, who can cook up a brand new version of the Cosmic Treadmill that can accommodate the whole team this time. So, using Naomi as a router, they decide to go all sliders and visit another world. The only problem is that once they're on the other side of the portal, Naomi ends up waking up all alone in the blighted hell world. And it's on that note right there, the comic comes to an end, everybody. And so that was Justice League issue number 60. And much like the issue that preceded it, Brian Michael Bendis brings his own trademark brand of breezy, casual dialogue to DC's greatest heroes. And at this point, I think you're either gonna love that sort of thing or hate it. Personally, I think there's worse things that the Justice League could have right now than basically get a new Avengers-style makeover, especially after the whole big world-ending, continuity-redefining events of Death Metal and the run that came before. I could joke all day about how the important character, the key to everything for Bendis' first Justice League run, just so happened to be a character he invented elsewhere, but for what it's worth, Naomi continues to be a lot of fun and actually serves as a good POV character for new Justice League readers. Hell, for what it's worth, I'm actually more enjoying Bendis' take on Superman here in this book than I did when he was writing two Superman books, probably because there's no Rogel Czar to ruin anything yet. I won't say that this book reinvents the wheel or will change the way you feel about Brian Michael Bendis as a writer, but for what it's worth, I did enjoy it, which is why I'm giving it a 7.5 out of 10.
Hey there everyone, Kate Joel again, and I just want to thank you so much for watching to the end of the video. It means a lot to me. And hey, if you enjoyed the book I covered in this issue and want some comics of your own, might I recommend Book Depository? It's my number one place for shopping for comic book trades. You get a great price, and if you use my link down in the description, you'll actually be helping me out at the same time. You get something, I get something, everybody wins, right? So until next time everyone, I've been Joel, and I will see you in the next video. Bye-bye.